In June 2020, the Russian government announced subsidies for electric vehicles produced in Russia, 25% of the retail price. A few months later, the Russian truck maker Kamaz announced that they have a passenger electric vehicle ready for serial production in 2021. Are you curious how a traditional truck maker is going to enter the electric passenger vehicle space? Subscribe to my YouTube channel and let's analyze it together.
Bakunin Live.
Kamaz is a traditional truck maker. It has been producing heavy trucks since 1969, and it's also very famous globally for winning almost all the trophies in the famous The Dakar Rally. Look at this monstrous track. Can you really imagine that this truck maker can produce tiny, low-weight, affordable city cars? Actually, I can. Kamaz is actually located in my home region back in Russia, and I remember after the Soviet Union collapse in the 90s, they were selling and producing a tiny city car called AK, and the number of sales was just amazing, 700,000 units in total. I'm guessing right now Kamaz decided to revive this segment to come back, and they're just going to leverage this unique opportunity with the governmental subsidies. And why not? The so-called mini EV segment is just booming right now in China. Wuling Hongguang Mini EV is the best seller in China. It's a joint venture between General Motors and SAIC. It sells more than Tesla Model 3, and the sales are roughly 20,000 units plus each month. Very good, outstanding results. And I think more or less the same will start happening in the US, because a Chinese car maker, EV car maker, Kandi, has entered the US market, and right now they are offering two low-cost models on their website. K27 after subsidies will cost you just $10,000. And I know, if I don't say it right now, you're gonna put it in my comments here below. The short seller research company Hindenburg just published a report accusing Kandi in wrongdoing. And of course, the shares of this company went down by almost 20%. And by the way, it's the same research company Hindenburg which was going after Nikola back in September. And the point is, the number of sales is overstated and they need an audit. Okay. My point is different. So what I am trying to say here, the mini EV segment is booming in China. The cars in this segment are best sellers. This also coming to the US. So why this cannot succeed in Russia? So why not? Okay, let's have a look at what Kamaz has to offer. It's called Kama-1. It's compact urban smart crossover, as they refer to it. It's a four-seater, 3.4 meters length, 1.7 meters width. If you look at the exterior, I am never ever satisfied with the designs of mini EVs. Are you? Maybe with one exception. It's a smart EV, I like it a lot, but if you like this one, please let me know in the comments down below. What's really exciting, this car has an impressive battery pack. It's 33 kilowatt hour battery for such a tiny and lightweight vehicle. I'm not surprised at all that the driving range is exceptional. They are declaring right now 187 miles on one charge, which is approximately 300 kilometers. I think it's a very, very good result, especially if you compare the energy efficiency with Tesla Model 3. Tesla Model 3 is famous for being super energy efficient, and it can consume 26 kilowatt hours for 100 miles. If you do basic calculation for Kama-1, it will be roughly 18 kilowatt hours for 100 miles, which means it must be better, much more energy efficient than Tesla Model 3. And I have some doubts here. I understand that the vehicle is very light and it's a very small compact car, but at the same time, the results are just outstanding. outstanding. I would rather wait for final certification and expect maybe some adjusted results at the end. But nevertheless, the range is quite good, strong. It's much better than what Nissan was offering back 10 years ago with the first generation Nissan Leaf and 24 kilowatt hour battery. So well done, good job, Kamaz. The top speed of this vehicle is 94 miles per hour, and which is very important, this vehicle can actually function under very, very cold temperatures, minus 50 degrees Celsius, which is maybe necessary in Russia, especially in Siberia. When it comes to pricing, Kama-1 will cost you roughly 1 million rubles in Russia, and that's just the basic version of it. If you deduct the subsidies, the total price to pay will be roughly $10,000. And in this particular segment, there is a very tough competition in Russia. I know this may not sound as a huge amount of money in a developed country such as the US, but in Russia this is probably the most massive mass market segment, and there is a lot of tough competition. I'm talking right now about Lada, Hyundai, Kia, Renault and others, so you have plenty of choices of traditional cars, larger and more roomier cars, so it's not an obvious choice for anyone to go for an electric vehicle for the same price. But if you're a really, really big fan of an electric car, another option you have is actually to buy a used car from Europe or Japan, and most likely it will be Nissan Leaf. The car maker Kamaz is announcing that they plan to sell roughly 20,000 units each year of Kama-1, and now I'm trying to scratch my head and understand how they're gonna do it. And practically speaking, if you want to boost sales, you already have subsidies, but you can also push the government to offer special perks and benefits for EV owners in big cities, and I'm talking right now about free parking and also access to bus lanes. Another option if you want to sell more of these vehicles is to offer them in car sharing or maybe goods delivery or food delivery spaces. Yes, this is how you make electric vehicles more efficient. You need to increase the utilization rate. So if this car is not parked and actually driving most of the time around the city, due to very low cost of ownership, you can actually compensate the very high upfront payment for this vehicle. In general, my home country, Russia, is heavily dependent on oil and gas. Nevertheless, I'm super happy with the new government under Mikhail Mishustin, and they are making this huge emphasis on electrification and reducing CO2 emissions. So this subsidy, 25% of the retail price, is a very good thing. It's actually incentivizing car makers to be more creative and enter the EV market space. So this is a very, very good starting point. Actually, if you look strategically on what has been happening across the world in the EV space, we have two different success stories. The first one, I mean, it's pretty obvious, but it's Tesla and Elon Musk with its strategy, the super famous smart plan of Elon Musk. When you go at the top of the pyramid, you address the most techy and most expensive segment, and year by year you make your vehicles more affordable for the mass market. Another strategy is coming actually from China. You will start with the very low cost cars, and you know, it's still the same situation right now in China. The best seller is a small mini EV, and you would leverage very small battery pack, lightweight but also very cheap labor in China to produce those cars. I think right now Russia is betting on those mini EVs, which is not a bad choice at all. And by the way, we are talking about Kama-1 in this video, but there is another vehicle which is called Zeta. We've seen a number of prototypes already. They are struggling with funding, but recently it looks like local government is going to support them a little bit in Samara and Tolyatti. And by the way, just for the record, one of the state officials in Samara recently said that Tesla wanted to acquire this small startup Zeta in Tolyatti just to make sure they can get rid of competition in Russia. Okay, but that was a joke. Nevertheless, I think what Russian companies are doing, they're trying to focus on low-cost vehicles vehicles, trying to leverage cheap labor available in Russia. Nevertheless, you know, Russia is also famous for its engineering, also software development. There are some IT companies which are famous globally, such as Yandex and Kaspersky, for instance. So why don't you also add some good user interfaces, user experience, connectivity, and try to mix tech with low-cost vehicles? I think it's a very unique opportunity. For this particular car, I know it's gonna be actually equipped with Google Auto and Yandex Auto. It's a very good and solid step, and I think Kamaz need to build on it. If you like this video, hit that subscribe button. See you next week.